أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نويت الأربعين نويت الاعتكاف نويت القلب ونويت العزل نويت الرياض نويت السلوك لله تعالى العظيم في هذا المسجد أطيع الله وأطيع الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. So Ubaydullah Al-Amawi is asking, still he is asking from yesterday till today. He's still asking. Sayyidina Abdul Khaliq al-Ghuzdwani about Ya Sayyidi, do I need to follow someone and take his hand to show me at-tariq, the way to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by giving initiation or accepting him as a murshid, although I have reached all these levels that we have described before, that I know all kinds of knowledges from under the throne, because believers, when they sleep, their soul goes to make sajda under the throne. And that's why from that secret of that sajda, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave visions and gave power for Awliyaullah to use the power of that sajda to reach, to take their student to reach the presence of Sayyidina Muhammad in 24 hours. So from the secret of that sajda came Salatul Najat, that we are praying two rak'at, and then after we finish, Salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, we go into sajda in order to be able to open these oceans of knowledges that are under the throne, under Al-Arsh. Arsh, we cannot say throne, no description for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that creature, that heavenly creature that He created.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى
الرحمن على العرش استوى. This is one of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah beliefs differ from the beliefs of other ideologies. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah first belief is that when you say, what you mean by Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa? Hal hada istiwa'un jismi? أو استواء لا كيف فيه. Is it a physical sitting on that, let's call it throne, what you can do on the throne, or is it a symbolic way of expressing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need a throne to sit on? Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe, and they express it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala overtook the throne. Allah doesn't need to sit on his throne. Overtook this throne. It is said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the throne, He created 19 angels to carry this throne. And Allah wants to show His power, Qudra, to angels in heavens. So these huge, undescribable angels that no one described them carried. They were lifting up the throne. And so they were happy. They were happy that they are doing so in carrying the throne, and all other angels were looking at them, surprising that Allah, how much power He gave His angel to carry the throne, where He says in the Ayatul Kursi, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The Kursi is not the throne. Kursi is not the Arsh. Arsh is different, Kursi is different. He says about the Kursi that وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, that the Kursi, the chair, if we can say chair, has bigger than this universe and than heavens. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم.
So his kursi overtook heavens and earth. And what do you think about the throne, the arsh? Overtook heavens and earth, and whatever other than heavens and earth Allah created, the Arsh overtook that. And Allah overtook everyone. So angels happy carrying, Allah ordered the Arsh to carry them. So after they were holding, you know, when you hold a chair, you hold it, you're giving pressure, force to hold. When Allah ordered Arsh to hold them, angels were falling, holding not to fall. So they found themselves, they have no power. When Allah wants to give power, will give. When Allah does not, He made the Arsh to carry them now, to show them, you are, my will is what is considered. So Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala la kayf, wa la mata, no how, or no time, nothing, no place, nothing. He overtook this throne. The other ideology, which you know it, say no, Allah sit physically on the chair. That is anthropomorphism. So Salatul Najat came from their secret. So when you do that sajda in Salatul Najat, you are doing that sajda under the throne. So dua there is accepted. Any dua. If you don't get it now, you get it after. If you don't get it after, you get it in the grave. For sure, at the death, you get it. So that's why it's important to pray Salatul Najat. I am saying to myself and to you, and the sajda. So that Ubaydullah al-Amawi was happy or proud showing that he knows something and say, oh, Ya Sayyidi, I know what happened to me on that sajda, what all these knowledges that was there, I am getting it. And I am becoming oceans because of that heavenly knowledge. So do that one who has all these heavenly knowledges that is opened to his heart, do he needs a murshid? Because he think himself he became murshid. Why to take another murshid? That is sickness. You think yourself, if you, as we said yesterday, from the signs of a munafiq, alimun bil lisan, jahulun bil qalb. Very eloquent in his speeches, he knows how to speak, but ignorant in his heart, as Prophet ﷺ described. So we are typing Japanese. Type Japanese. Show her how to type Japanese. Aha. Alimun bil lisan, jahulun bil qalb. Knows how to speak, but no ignorant in his heart. And this is applied on those who study Islamic studies from teachers who are not Muslim, or from teachers who are Muslim but not practicing. There are a lot of them. So how these people, they know how to speak, but they are ignorant in their hearts, so they are not tasting the taste. So Ubaydullah Al-Amawi, tasting. That's why he wants to know the truth. So he was in the level of inheriting from Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. That's why you call him Musawi. Inheriting from the secret of Sayyidina Musa, that's why he inherited too much questions. Asking to get the truth. And when he came to the truth, Sayyidina Musa, Allah sent him to one of his servants, one, not two. He was stunned. Oh, what's this? The servant said, you cannot go along with me. إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. How you are going to be patient for something you never learned or see? So that's why for us, we have to understand that whenever we don't see something and never heard it, we don't believe in it.
You don't accept it.
We don't accept. If you accept, you are submitting, Allah will open. That's why important al-iman bil-ghayb. To believe in the unseen. That's why when Prophet sallallahu alaihi asked Sahaba, who is the best of people, best of creation, they say Prophet. Said, how is Prophet when they are seeing what they are seeing? How Prophets are the best? Of course they are in their rank the best, yes. The best. Allah honored them to be Prophets. Said, but why to believe who are the best of people that they have faith to believe in the unseen? They said, the prophets. He said, how the prophet, when they are seeing what they are seeing, when they are getting messages, where Jibreel alayhi salam is coming, how they are going up to accept? Then they said, angels. He said, angels? Also they are seeing and praising their Lord day and night, and seeing what they are seeing, how they are not going to be accepting. Then they said, oh, then us, Ya Rasulullah. We are the one. He said, you? Hey, you are seeing me. You are seeing the truth. How you are not going to believe? Then they said, Ya Rasulullah, who are these people then? He said, those who will come in after me, they believe in me without seeing me, are my beloved ones, are ikhwani, my brothers. Look, Prophet said, he didn't say only my beloved, he said, ikhwani, my brothers, means he makes them equal in blood. That they have that secret, blood secret, physical secret. So Ubaydullah al-Amawi is saying, if someone knows all these knowledges, is he in need for a tariqah? Or he knows and he say, I know all these knowledges, I learned all different school of thought, I'm seeing paradises, all what is in paradise, I can count them for you piece by piece, and their awalimuha, and all its
university,
and all whatever inside these paradises, I know all of them. And I am looking on all prophets and learning from them through their graves. And I hear the praises, glorifications of every creature on earth or in ocean or in air, sky. I can move in space and reach anyone. I learned all the ahadith, I learned the Holy Quran. So still do I need a wali, a someone to guide me? I mean, I am so powerful. He said, look at all these students, they don't see what you see, but they are better than you.
Why?
Because you seeing what you are seeing and still you are not submitting. They are not seeing anything and they are submitting. Look, the difference is the one with too much knowledge, he become arrogant. That's why professors, you know professors? Are you a professor?
No.
Professors, any profession, they think they conquered heavens, like Namrud. Namrud, why he threw Sayyidina Ibrahim in fire? Because he was telling him, you are not my Lord. How am I not your Lord? Then you are not. Say, oh, we are worshipping all these statues, and one of them, the biggest statue, is my statue. Statue?
No.
So why? He said, no, tomorrow we see. Next day, what Sayyidina Ibrahim did? He cut their head, all of these statues, by an axe. And he left Namrud's head there. He didn't cut it. Next day they came to the shrine, they saw all these heads being cut. Got angry. Went to Namrud, oh, our master. This is what happened. He said, oh, يقال له إبراهيم فتن يقال له إبراهيم
يقال له إبراهيم قالوا سمعنا فتن يذكر يقال له إبراهيم قال فأتي به على أعين الناس لعلهم يشهدون قالوا أأنت فعلت هذا بآلهتنا يا إبراهيم قال بل فعله كبيرهم هذا فاسألوهم إن كانوا ينطقون فرجعوا إلى أنفسهم فقالوا إنكم أنتم الظالمون.
Who did that with our Lord's God? Oh, why your gods cannot protect themselves? He said, oh, we heard a young one. His name is Ibrahim. We think that he is that one who cut their heads. So Namrud called him. Said Ibrahim coming, slowly walking, arriving, and Namrud saying to him and all his ministers, cabinet, arrogant people, professors, universities, all universities arrogant. In their way of handling things, because they tell you, oh, criticize everyone. Don't accept anyone. Bring all their mistakes. That's why dissertation of PhD, what they do? They bring all your mistakes. For what? Someone spent 2 years writing his best. Well, they give him A+, Allah, move him forward. No, you have to bring all his mistakes. Allah is a sattar. Allah say, I veil people's mistake, my servant's mistake. Why you are bringing it up? So that Ibrahim said, oh, what happened? He said, you went yesterday to the shrine? Yes? You saw these, their heads are chopped? He said, yes. He said, who did that? He said, who did that? You say yourself you are God, you don't know who did that? Go and ask the biggest one, whose head is still there. He'll give you the answer. Eh, how to ask? A statue. So they knew that they were wrong. So he wants to revenge, he put him in fire, submitting. Namrud, what he did? He built a huge
bonfire.
A huge minaret. And went and shoot in the sky. And then Allah brought a bird to be hit with that. And then all blood coming on the arrow. When the arrow that came down, the Muslim said, look, I killed him, the one on paradise, in heaven. I killed the Lord of Ibrahim. See arrogance, how much it makes people to become unbelievers. If you say God today, if you say word God or Allah or God in English or Dieu in French, people look at you awkward, back, disgusted. Religion, there is no religion here. We went with Maulana Sheikh to United Nations, was I think 1998. And Maulana wants to pray, either 1998 or 1996, one of them. So Maulana wants to pray, we went, took him to United Nations, he wants to pray. And one of these corners, huge area, open space in the first floor. People goes there, registered. We're praying in the corner and security came. What you are doing? You are praying. No, you cannot pray here. Why you cannot pray here? Because there is no God here. Here no God. You want to pray, go somewhere, there is God. Here no God. Like you have 70, 80 Muslim countries. How God is not here? You have also many non-Muslim countries, Christian countries, or Jewish countries. How there is no God here? Arrogance. So he said, I have all these knowledges. Do I still need a teacher to give me tariqah, or I can move forward? And then he said, but ya Sayyidi, let me tell you the truth. I don't feel, although I know all these knowledges, I feel not content. Something missing. And I cannot know what is that missing. That's why I'm bringing all these questions. Wherever I enter a new ocean of knowledge, or wherever I enter in visions, different envisioning, you say, different issues, heavenly issues, I still feel there is major issue, major thing, make me not happy, not content. I'm trying my best. That's why I came to you. You said, mashallah, you came with all this luggage of questions. He's asking questions since 4 sessions we are listening to his questions. Every session, 40 minutes. How many minutes total? 160 minutes, 3 hours of questions alone with his question. Alhamdulillah, we learned something. It's good for Ubaydullah Al-Amawi. And all these questions I answered to you. You were not satisfied. Now you're coming to me at the end and you ask me more questions. إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعِيَ صَبْرًا وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. You are not going to be able to follow me and to be with my company. How you are going to be with the company of Awliya Allah when you cannot understand what they are doing? There is a stair, you go downstairs. Awliya Allah are strange. For example, I'm giving a physical example. Everyone goes from there. But the wali, for example, he goes from the other stairs. Where you are going from there? This is the main stair here inside the building. No, I have to go outside the building and come in. This is strange or not? No. You become to have doubts. Why they are doing that? No, there might be hikmah to someone. Wali is outside waiting for him to meet with him spiritually. So he has to go the other way, for example. So their ways are completely different. He says something to you, he means another thing. That you have to be very careful. But you have to be very careful, because some people, they take this as a excuse and they don't listen to the Sheikh completely. They say, oh, he says something, he means another thing. No. He doesn't in that level. He is in the highest level, yes. When you reach maqam, first step in maqam al-wilaya, they have to teach you how to get a clear and clean picture, not a fuzzy picture. Fuzzy picture means your receiver is not good. You cannot listen to your ego, because your ego will tell you, oh, he said this, but he meant this. Who gave you the authority to say he meant this? Why you became, mashallah, better? He can say it by himself. If he wants the people to know why he meant this, he would have told to people. You are a pioneer to tell on his behalf. Unless if you have the authority. So he said, Ya Waladi, O my son, Sayyidina Abdul Khalq, he said, O my son, with all these knowledges that you asked me and you have reached, I have to ask you one question. I listened to you, I answered everything, but now is my turn to ask you one question. And very simple question. It's one sentence, half sentence maybe. If you feel yourself you can answer, then you don't need me. You don't need a murshid. You go, you move by yourself. If you think that you need me to answer, you need me to explain to you, you don't have an answer for it, then you are obliged to have a guide. That's why it's important for people to have a guide and to know to have a guide and to be lucky to find the real one from the fake one. But Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani said, if you see someone flying in the air, say that is shaitan, is not a wali. Wali will not show. He has no ego to show that he can fly in air. So there are fake ones that they can fly in air by using jinn. So people believe in them because they are being possessed. They can use jinn to harm a human being, and that's why this black magic comes too much. We have too many questions comes a day about black magic on the internet. Coming from what? From fake ones. Because anyone using jinn for destruction is a fake one. And when you say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, their magic would fall down. In Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin, Grand Sheikh used to say a story about Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin. There is a big mosque in Istanbul. It was a church before and they turned it into a mosque. And it is called the Hagia Sophia now, mosque, but they turn it into a museum now. And one time, Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin, he has a debate with some unbelievers, non-Muslims. So they were in Hagia Sophia, they had the meeting, because Hagia Sophia was open at that time, 90 years ago. And grand Sheikh, Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin, that's telling me, Allah bless his soul, was debating with them and he was winning on them. So they entered Hagia Sophia Mosque and people were looking and they were able to fly from earth, from ground, up to the balcony. Flying up, rising up, coming down, rising up, coming down. All of them, like 40 of them. They were priests. There's too many seclusions. Allah will give power. They got power of jinn. They were coming, going up, coming up, going down. So people were stunned. They say, oh, they are the one with the truth. Yeah. Although Sheikh Sharafuddin gave them, one of them was debating them, but when they did that action, many people were footing them, confused. They become a big fitna. they are seeing them going up and going down. So what he did, Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin, in order to stop their black magic, this is black magic. That's why if you go into this, today they have many shows, they show you people with black magic. If you can do what Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin did, you stop their black magic. And there is no permission now in these days. So what he did, Sayyidina Sheikh Sharafuddin, and what Sayyidina Abdul Khaliq al-Ujdawani answered his student, we leave it to tomorrow. Thank you.